Matthew chapter 27, a long chapter. And if we think about the time of year, it's a time where a lot of people celebrate the holiday called Easter. And you know, as growing up, there was a lot of holidays that you celebrate as a kid, and people would ask you, hey, what is Easter about? And I think a lot of kids probably wouldn't even have any idea. They think it's about, you know, hunting Easter eggs. They think it's about chasing some chocolate bunny. They say, well, we go to church. And you say, well, what was so special? They're like, I don't know. we just go to church on Easter one time a year. I think it's really important to understand what happens when you celebrate a big event. Like, if you're going to celebrate an event, you should at least understand why you're celebrating it. But let's look at Matthew 28. Let's kind of finish this thought that we've been building in Matthew 27. Look at verse 1. It says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back a stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, fear not, ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come, see the place where the Lord lay. So we have in this chapter 27, in the beginning of chapter 28, the gospel. We have the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's the whole point of celebrating Easter. But you know, there's a lot of other things that took place during this time. And if we look at, if you try to see, well, where are we at in that timeline? Because people are going to celebrate Easter on Sunday. Well, today's Thursday. So where are we at? What's happening? Well, the title of my sermon tonight is Jesus and Judas Went to Hell. We got to understand that there's a lot more that happened than just the death, burial, and resurrection. And I think it's very important to understand this point. It has so much doctrine that hinges on it. There's so many things that are taught. But if we know that Jesus Christ rose early on the first day of the week, then we can kind of figure out, hey, where are we at in this timeline? What's happening? Well, we see there in verse 1 of 28, it says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. So Mary and Magdalene and the Mary, they're coming, and it's not even light yet. So it's still dark. So you'd say, well, what time of day is that? Well, let's just, for easy math, say it gets dark at 6 p.m. and it gets light at 6 a.m. So they're coming before 6 a.m. on Sunday morning. They're coming late, at least 5 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 3 o'clock. We don't really know exactly when they started going or when they showed up. We just know before is when it was about to start dawning. So if Jesus Christ was in the grave, let's go to Matthew 12. Just flip back a couple chapters. Keep your finger there, though. Go back just to Matthew chapter 12. Let's look at one other verse before we get this thought. It says in verse 39, but he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. So Jesus Christ said he was for 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Well, we know that someday he wasn't there because he already rose. He already rose before the dawning of the day. So, and if he rose sometime at the earlier of the day, meaning it was before 6 o'clock, it wasn't really a full night. If he rose early, that means he wasn't even there for Saturday night, which would have been kind of coming into Sunday morning. Because if you look at our calendar today, time starts at 12 a.m. in the morning and ends at 12 p.m. But the Bible says in Genesis there was evening and the morning the first day. So a day starts at night. If he rose early, that means he probably rose sometime shortly after 6 p.m. So if we're going to start, where are we going to start? Saturday night at about 6 p.m. is where we're going to start. So let's count backwards. Let's just see. So you go to Saturday, so we have one day. And then you can go to Friday night. So now we have one day and one night. Now, let's pause here for a second, because most people tomorrow are going to celebrate a day called Good Friday, where they're going to celebrate the fact that Jesus Christ died on the cross on a Friday. Well, the Bible makes it clear that it was about an even when he died and gave up the ghost. So according to their, you know, definition, he was only in there for one day and one night, which just completely invalidates Matthew chapter 12. But I'm not going to believe man. I'm not going to trust what man teaches. I'm just going to believe what the Bible says. So let's keep counting. We had Saturday, It was one day, and we had Friday night. So then we have Friday, and then we have what? Thursday night. Then we have what? Thursday, and then we have Wednesday night. So the Bible makes it clear Jesus Christ were 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, and he rose early on the first day of the week, which would have been Saturday night, maybe 6:30 or 7 o'clock, right after, you know, it became evening. Then we would know what? He died on Wednesday evening at about 6 p.m. And I'm not going to preach a whole sermon on that. I think it's really interesting, but it helps us decide, well, where are we at? Because if Easter's going to be Sunday morning, and he died on Wednesday, well, where's Jesus? He's in hell. And guess who else is there? Judas Iscariot. But my first point is, let's look at Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ died on Wednesday night and went to hell. That's my first point. Let's prove this from the Bible. Very important doctrine. Go to Psalms chapter 16, if you will. Psalms chapter 16. I'll read from you from Acts 2. The Bible says, "For David speaketh concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption." So clearly the Bible says, look, Jesus Christ's soul is not left in hell. We know that he rose. We already read that in Matthew 28. But he did go to hell according to this verse. Look at Psalm 16, where as you turn to verse 9. "Therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope, for thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption." Now, if we just believe the Bible says out of the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established, we can just say, hey, he went to hell. But you know, there's a lot of people that don't believe that. They teach a false doctrine. They reject the fact that Jesus Christ went to hell. So I have an example of that, because if I'm going to say someone does it, let's get an example. So I went to a site called gotquestions.org. There was a question that says, did Jesus go to hell between his death and resurrection? I'll read for you not the whole article, but a couple of excerpts. They say the concept that Jesus went to hell after his death on the cross comes primarily from the Apostles' Creed, which states he descended into hell. Now, I didn't mention the Apostles' Creed one time. I'm just mentioning the King James Bible. We're just mentioning the fact that in Matthew chapter 12, in Acts chapter 2, in Psalms chapter 16, it clearly said he went to hell. But that's just a straw man argument to say, well, it's Catholic. It's just a Catholic doctrine. No, anything that's true came from the Bible, and they just copied it, or they just got lucky. But the Bible, this article says, continues, it says, many people refer both Hades and the lake of fire as hell, and this causes confusion. Jesus did not go to a place of torment after his death, but he did go to Hades. So they're trying to say that there's a separation of a place called Hades and hell, where Hades is this good place to go. Now, I don't know, I'm not an expert on Hades. I just know that a Greek mythology is considered the place of the dead. Doesn't sound like a great place to go. I don't want to go there. But they try to say, well, you know, this is causing confusion. The only reason it's causing confusion is because they're reading a false Bible version. Because this book never says Hades one time. But I'll keep reading. It says some of the confusion has arisen from such passages as Psalm 16, 10 through 11, as translated in the King James Version. So he's saying, look, it's really confusing when you read the Word of God, when you read the Word perfect, you know, the inerrant King James Bible that says he clearly went to hell. That's confusing. Because we know he didn't go there. But I know the Bible says it. That seems confusing. Well, it's only confusing because they have a preconceived idea in their mind. And they even quote the verse. They say, "For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life." They say, well, hell is not correctly translated in this verse. A correct translation would read the grave or Sheol. But the Bible makes it clear that, you know, Jesus Christ did go to hell, not just from that verse. We're going to look at a lot of their verses. They said some have the viewpoint that Jesus went to hell or the suffering side of Sheol and Hades in order to further be punished for our sins. This idea is completely unbiblical. They're saying that it's unbiblical to believe what the Bible plainly said, where it just spells it out. He went to hell. They're basically saying the King James Bible is just a big old lie. It's unbiblical. You shouldn't even read it. They're attacking Jesus Christ because he is the Word. They said, well, you know, some examples would be in John 19 where it says, it is finished. But the question is, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, what if Jesus Christ never rose from the dead? Is anybody saved? No! So is it really finished? If you look up what it means to be finished, it's saying that he finished his earthly ministry. He finished all the work on this planet. Yeah. What was his job on the planet? To die on the cross. So it's finished. But our salvation isn't finished. There's no context of eternal life or salvation in that verse. The Bible says he went to Abraham's side, or the blessed side of Hades. Apparently Jesus went to the blessed side of Hades. That just sounds more Catholic than anything that they could ever say the King James Bible is. So they finish up the article, did Jesus go to hell? No. Did Jesus go to Sheol Hades? Yes. So they're hinging everything on these false Bible versions. They're leaning on, you know, these fake words of God, these modern corruptions. Yeah. And I pulled up Psalm 16 from some different versions, where it says in verse 10, "That for thou wilt not leave my soul in hell." The NIV says, "Abandon me to the realm of the dead." To the realm of the dead. That just sounds like a horror film. I don't even know what that is. But it's just confusing. Because anybody really, you say, what's the realm of the dead? Nobody's going to have any idea what that is. They're all going to have a different idea. And that's what these modern perversions are like. They're vague. They don't have any real power. They don't actually explain anything. The King James Bible makes it clear it's hell. New King James says, not leave my soul in Sheol. Now, nobody in the world knows what Sheol is. I mean, it's just a confusing word. Nobody has any idea. I mean, according to the theologians, they say it just means the grave. But we know that Jesus Christ went to the, when he died. I mean, we're not always going to argue with that. But it just begs the question. Because always the question is, where did Jesus go after he died? And they say, well, he died. That doesn't answer the question. They're just basically not answering the question by saying he went to Sheol. And then the NLT says, do not leave my soul among the dead. So again, they're just kind of pushing off to the grave or to the dead. They don't actually answer the question. And so this God Questions org has to make something up and say he went to the blessed side of Hades. Whatever that is. I don't even know what it is. That's why you shouldn't go to these websites and get answers from them. No, you should get them from the King James Bible, which is clear, which is perfect, which will give you a straight answer. But let's really prove this, because I believe it from two or three witnesses. But let's really prove this from the Bible. Go to Revelation chapter 1. In Acts chapter 2, the Bible says in verse 31, he seeing this before spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. A verse I always like to show people when I go out soul winning. Look, his soul is not left in hell because he rose again. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 20, a lot of people use this verse. In 14 it says, and death and hell were cast in the lake of fire. This is the second death. Now the Bible makes a parallel in the, of the death being equal to hell a lot of ways. Where if you die, you're in hell. Because it's synonymous in the Bible. When we look at the Revelation chapter 1, keeping that in mind, look at verse 18. I am he that liveth and was dead. Now, based on the verse 20 of Revelation, where is death? It's in hell. So if Jesus Christ was dead, that means he was in hell. Because being dead, you're either in heaven or you're in hell. But the Bible says that to be dead is not to be in heaven. God is not the God of the death. Yeah. He's the God of the living. So if you're living, you're in heaven. That's why Jesus Christ said, I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. So we see a transition where he was alive, then he died, meaning went to hell, and then behold, he's alive forevermore. But look at the last part of this verse. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. Now, how does that verse make any sense if Jesus never went to hell? I mean, it doesn't even make any sense. It makes perfect sense if he went to hell, if he conquered death, if he conquered hell, and came back out of the grave and rose. He rose. He has the keys to hell and death. He's conquered it. Now we can go to heaven because he's conquered death and hell for us. But they want to say, well, he went to the blessed side of Hades. You say, well, how did he get the keys to hell? I'm like, I don't know, I guess because he's God. I mean, they don't even have an explanation. It just makes this verse, it just renders it useless. But if we understand the fact that Jesus Christ conquered death and hell, then we know, oh, he got the keys to hell and of death. Why? Because without him getting the key, you would go to hell forever. But Jesus Christ took the punishment we deserve so we could have the key so we could go to heaven. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. That's why in 1 Corinthians 15, the Bible says, the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. So death is an enemy, and death is synonymous with being in hell. The Bible says that hell delivered up the dead. The hell and death are synonymous in the Bible. Now, of course, our fleshly body, it will, you know, decay, and will sow in incorruption, and will reap. Will sow in corruption, and will reap an incorruptible body. Right? The Bible says in Romans 10, it says, "But this is the righteousness which is of faith, speaketh on this wise: Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down from above. Or who shall descend into the deep? That is to bring up Christ again from the dead." So the Bible says, look, Jesus Christ descended into the deep. Where what is? Where the dead are. Now, is that where heaven is? Is heaven in the deep? And if you go in the Old Testament, you'll see so many references to hell being the pit, of going down deep into the pit where the dead are. And if the dead are in the deep pit, guess what that's called? Hell! So Jesus Christ descended into the deep. And no one else could do that. But Jesus Christ descended by his own will. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, keeping that in mind. Look at verse 8. Wherefore he saith, when he ascendeth up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. So we see again, he descended first into the lower parts of the earth. How are you going to define that? Well, it's either hell or it's hell, according to the King James Bible. So they say, well, what do the modern versions do? How do these guys not believe it? Well, they change it here too. The NIV says that he didn't descend first in the lower parts of the earth. He descended to the lower earthly regions. Now, I don't even know what the earthly regions are. I mean, you could probably define this as maybe like the continents, maybe like the Americas, or just an area somewhere, maybe the Phoenix region. I mean, it's so vague again. They're not giving you any specific details. They're not making it easier to be understood. Everybody understands hell, but you say, hey, where's the earthly region? I mean, you're never going to get the same answer. Everybody's going to give you a different answer. It's just completely subjective. The ESV says that he went into the lower regions, the earth. So they kind of give you an actual definition. They say, well, the lower regions is just the earth. So he went to the earth. But we all know that he was on the earth. And the NLT says, to our lowly world. So they just want to basically take out this whole part of the Bible. They're saying, well, Jesus came to the earth. But it's not saying he went to hell. He didn't descend down into hell. Go to, keep your finger there and flip to Exodus chapter 29. Exodus chapter 29. And I'll read for you. Well, yeah. Go to Exodus 29 verse 18. I'll give you just a second. We're going to see two other verses. I mean, we've seen so many different ways that Jesus Christ went to hell. It clearly says that his soul is not left in hell. It clearly says that he descended into the deep. It says that he has the keys of death and hell. I mean, it says it over and over in all kinds of different ways. It says that he was dead, but now he's alive. In Exodus 29, verse 18, the Bible says, and thou shalt burn the whole ram upon the altar. It is a burnt offering unto the Lord. It is a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord. So flip back where you were and go to Ephesians chapter 5. So if you say that Jesus Christ didn't go to hell, you basically ruin all the Old Testament sacrifices. Because one thing you'll notice if you read the Old Testament, which most people never do, is that every offering is a burnt offering. I mean, it's a burnt offering over here, and the ram's a burnt offering, and the lamb's a burnt offering, and they're offering all these burnt offerings over and over and over. Why are they being burned? Why is he saying the whole burnt offering? But he said it's a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord. Look at Ephesians chapter 5. Look at verse 2. And walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. So again, if Jesus Christ was this sweet smelling savor, sounds like he was the whole burnt offering. And Jesus, in the Old Testament, when it's talking about the lamb, which is going to be Jesus Christ, it says to do the whole thing. I mean, don't leave any part of it. Burn the whole thing. Jesus Christ's soul went down to hell because all the Old Testament sacrifices were just a perfect picture of what Jesus Christ would do. The fact that he would die on the cross, be buried, and rise again from hell, and that we could just believe his gospel to be saved. This is a very important doctrine because it sheds so much light on why we have the Old Testament sacrifices. It sheds so much light on how Jesus Christ has the keys of hell and death. It sheds light on the fact of why Jesus Christ, we could be forgiven because he paid for all of our sins. He took the punishment that we deserve, making God just. What if God never punished Jesus Christ? Well, then he wouldn't be just because nobody paid the penalty for our sin. But Jesus Christ paid the full penalty for our sin. He died on the cross, and then he went to hell to suffer. I mean, there's a lot of people that died on the cross, but nobody took the punishment of hell for you. Nobody took the punishment that we deserve to go to hell. It just takes away all of that from Jesus Christ's glory. And you know, when you're celebrating in this time, when Jesus Christ was in hell, they're going to celebrate the crucifixion tomorrow. They're going to celebrate on Good Friday the crucifixion, which is just false, which is just a lie. But not only was Jesus Christ in hell, he wasn't there by himself. Go back to Matthew chapter 26. And I'm going to go back to Matthew 27, our main chapter, where we read. There was another guy that went to hell that same day. It says in Matthew 27, verse 1, when the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned and that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed, and went and hanged himself. Now a lot of people throughout history have asked this question, well, where did Judas go? I mean, he was Jesus Christ's follower for 3.5 years, but then he killed himself. Now a lot of people get the right answer, but for the wrong reason. They'll say, well, of course Judas is in hell, because he killed himself, because he hanged himself. And anybody that kills himself will go to hell automatically. Now when I was growing up, I heard this as a verse in the Bible. There was some verse in the Bible that said if you kill yourself, it's an automatic ticket to hell. But that's not true. Right. And you know what? It's really confusing to tell somebody there's a verse in the Bible that says something when it doesn't, because you'll never find it. You're always like, where's that one verse? I just can't find it, because it's not there. Because the Bible says if you kill yourself, even if you were to commit such a selfish, wicked sin, if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll go to heaven when you die. Just like Saul, just like Samson, these men took their own lives, but we know they're in heaven, not because they weren't a sinner, but because they had faith in the Lord, because they were saved by their faith. But look at Matthew 26, back up one chapter, look at verse 20. I have 6 reasons why Judas Iscariot was a reprobate who went to hell. Judas Iscariot was a reprobate who went to hell. Let's get 6 reasons, 6 for the number of man, and 6 and 6, because it's the number of Satan, it's the number of the beast, right? Look at Matthew 26, verse 20. It says, now when the even was come, he sat down with the 12, and as they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? And he answered and said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. The Son of Man goeth as it is written of him, but woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? He said unto him, thou hast said. So we see here in verse 24 a pretty condemning statement. I mean, this is the Lord Jesus Christ sitting down at the Last Supper with his disciples, and he says, the person that betrayed me, it had been good for that man to have never been born, never existed. Why? Because dying and going to hell is worse than never even existing. To spend an eternity in flames, to spend an eternity in darkness, and outer darkness, the weeping and gnashing of teeth. But we know the Bible says that the untimely, that Job says, it would have been better if he had died at the untimely birth of a woman. than to go through the sufferings and afflictions of life. Because why? Going to heaven then wouldn't have been great. I mean, who doesn't want to live an eternity with God in heaven? I mean, even if you had to suffer this, the worst life you could ever imagine, maybe for 100 years, it would be nothing in eternity. In heaven, you wouldn't wish that you'd never been born. But if you're going to spend eternity in hell, yeah, I would never want to have been born. I would never want to have to burn for eternity and the smoke of my torment ascend up forever and ever. So point number one, he should never have been born. The Bible says about false prophets, cursed children. Go to, the second point here is verse 25. Just go to the next verse. It says, then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? He said unto him, Thou hast said. Now back up just a few verses in Matthew 26. Go to verse 14. Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests and said unto them, What will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you. And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. And from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him. Now Judas Iscariot already went to the chief priests. He already decided in his heart, I'm going to betray Jesus Christ for money. I don't care anymore. I just want some money. He was just a wicked reprobate. And guess what? Then he's sitting there and Jesus Christ is saying, what if he's going to betray me? What if he's going to give me up? It'd be better for him not to have ever been born than the person that betrayed me. And Judas is like, I must have been caught. I mean, he knows it's me. He says, Lord, is it I? He says, Thou hast said. But guess what? How implacable does someone have to be to know that they're the ones that are going to betray him? They already have it in their heart. Jesus Christ confronts you. He says it's better if you've never been born, and then you just go do it anyways again. I mean, that's what the Bible means by implacable. It means there's nothing that can stop the guy. If the Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh can confront you and say, what in the world are you doing? It would have been better if you've never been born. It's the worst thing you could ever think of. He's like, I'm going to still do it. I mean, he just talks about the fact that Judas was so reprobate in his heart. He's just implacable. He was just going to deny the Christ forever. It doesn't matter. He hated Christ in his heart. That's why he betrayed him. So the second point is that Judas was implacable. I mean, what person could sit at a dinner table with the Lord Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, knowing that you're going to betray him? He confronts you to the face, and then you immediately go out and betray him. I mean, that just talks about the most hardened heart that you could possibly imagine. Someone who was twice dead, as the Bible would say. Look at verse 45 down here in Matthew 26. It says, Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. And while he yet spake, lo, Judas, one of the 12, came, and with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now he that betrayeth him gave him a sign, saying, Whomsoever I shall kiss, that same is he. Hold him fast. And forthwith he came to Jesus and said, Hail, Master, and kissed him. And Jesus said unto him, Friend, wherefore art thou come? Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. So we see this wicked reprobate, he even comes up to Jesus Christ, pretends to be his friend, and gives him the kiss of death, as it were. Go to Mark chapter 14. I'm just going to read for you a slew of verses. The Bible says in John 13, and supper being ended, the devil now put in the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Mark 3 says, and Judas Iscariot, which also betrayed him, and they went into a house. Luke 22, but Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? Matthew 26, 14, from that time he sought opportunity to betray him. Mark 14, and he sought how he might conveniently betray him. Matthew chapter 10, Simon the Canaanite and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. Luke 6, and Judas the brother of James and Judas Iscariot, which was also the traitor. John chapter 13, for he knew who should betray him, therefore said he, Ye are not all clean. Jesus Christ knew that Judas Iscariot wasn't clean from his sin. Why? Because he was a reprobate. Because he wasn't a saint. He wasn't born again. And he was going to betray Christ. Look at Mark 14, look at verse 41. And he cometh the third time and saith unto them, Sleep on now, and take your rest. It is enough, the hour is come. Behold, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise up, let us go. Lo, he that betrayeth me is at hand. Look at verse 45. And as soon as he was come, he goeth straightway to him and saith, Master, Master, and kissed him. Sounds like the people in Matthew chapter 7 that say, Lord, Lord. I mean, he's calling him master, but he gives him the kiss of death. And the Bible makes it clear that Judas Iscariot was a traitor. He was someone who betrayed the Lord Jesus Christ. Why is he in hell? Well, he gave the kiss of death. Who could do that but someone who's reprobate? The Bible says in 2 Peter and Jude, talking about people that are feasting with you. They have their hearts sealed with a hot iron. They can just sit there and they can feast with you. They can give you a kiss on the cheek. They can call you friend. But inside they're going to betray you. They're a traitor. The only type of person like that is a reprobate. I mean, the Bible makes it clear that's what those people are like. And who could be around Jesus Christ's ministry for 3.5 years, not be saved, and betray him and be saved? I mean, you can't be saved. I mean, you've heard the gospel a billion times probably. But look at John chapter 13. So the third point is that he gave the kiss of death, that he had no fear. He didn't have any fear. He was just feasting with Christ with no fear. I mean, he was a betrayer the whole time. The Bible makes it clear from the beginning of the ministry he was a betrayer to the end. Jesus knew he was always a betrayer. He was always wicked to his core. Look at John chapter 13, verse 21. The Bible says, when Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. So Jesus Christ, he confronted the disciples many times, saying, look, there's somebody here that's a liar, that's a traitor, that's going to betray me. It's one of you. Look at verse 27. It says, and after the sop sent, Satan entered into him, then said Jesus unto him, that thou doest, do quickly. Now no man at the table knew for what intent he spake this unto him. For some of him then thought, because Judas had the bag, that Jesus said unto him, buy those things that we have need of against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. He then, having received the sop, went immediately out, and it was night. Look at the first part of verse 27. It says, and after the sop, Satan entered into him. Why was Judas Iscariot a reprobate that went to hell? Because Satan entered into his body. Satan can't enter into the body of a believer. That's why it says in 1 John chapter 5, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not, but he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. A believer can't be touched by Satan in the fact that he can't enter into their body, he can't possess their body, he can't possess the new spirit that's been born of God. So that proves that Judas Iscariot was not born of God. Why? Because he was a reprobate that went to hell. So not only was he a liar, a betrayer, not only was he not, should have never been born according to Jesus Christ's mouth, not only was he implacable, not only give the kiss of death, not fearing the Lord, not only was he possessed by Satan, look at, go to Psalms chapter 109. It says in Acts, I'll read for you, it says, and in those days Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of the names together were about 120. Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost spake by the mouth of David, spake concerning before Judas, which was guided to them that took Jesus, for he was numbered with us, and had obtained part of this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong he burst asunder in the midst, and all his bowels gushed out. And it is known unto all the dwellers at Jerusalem, insomuch as that field is called their proper tongue, Alcedama. That is to say, the field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and let his bishopric take, let another take. Now, the Bible's quoting there in the Old Testament. I think when you read the Old Testament passages, it makes it pretty clear this guy's not a saved person. It's not a person that the Lord Jesus Christ is going to bless. I'll read for you from Psalm 69, and then we'll go to Psalms 109. It says in Psalm 69, it says, pour out thine indignation upon them, and let thy wrathful anger take hold of them. Let their habitation be desolate, and let none dwell in their tents, for they persecute him whom thou hast smitten, and they talk to the grief of those whom thou hast wounded. Look at Psalms 109, verse 6. Set thou a wicked man over him, and let Satan stand at his right hand. Sound familiar? Judas Iscariot was entered by Satan. Look at verse 7. When he shall be judged, let him be condemned, and let his prayer become sin. Let his days be few, and let another take his office. Let his children be fatherless, and his wife a widow. That's why it also says in Acts chapter 1 that he might take part of this ministry and apostleship, talking about the person they cast lots for, from which Judas by his transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. So the Bible says in Acts that Judas Iscariot went to his own place. Now if he went to be gathered unto his own people, he would have been in heaven. Because the Bible makes it clear when you're gathered unto your people, when you're gathered unto the Lord, that you're all together. But if he went to his own place, it had to be somebody else. If all the apostles are going to one place, and Judas Iscariot is going to his own place, it has to be somewhere else. Well, the Bible makes it clear there is no Sheol, there's no Hades. There's only two places you can go, heaven or hell. That's why my fifth point is he went to his own place, hell. But maybe if you weren't convinced, this is just the most condemning evidence. Go to John chapter 6. You say, why did Judas Iscariot die and go to hell? Well, it makes it pretty clear when Jesus Christ said that he should not have been born. It made it pretty clear when he was so implacable. It made it pretty clear when he gave the kiss of death, when he was possessed by Satan, when the Bible says he went to his own place. But look at John 6, verse 61. It says, when Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, does this offend you? What if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not, and who should betray him. And he said, therefore, said I unto you, that no man can come unto me, except it were given unto him of my Father. From that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered them, have not I chosen you 12? And one of you is a devil. He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. For he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. So Jesus Christ said, look, there's some of you that don't believe. There's one of you that's a devil. Why did Judas Iscariot go to hell? Because he didn't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't actually believe him. He was a devil. A devil means to be against, or to be, you know, an adversary. It's talking about someone who's against Christ. Why? Because he betrayed him. Because he did not believe on him. He believed not. And the Bible says, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Why did Judas Iscariot go to hell? Well, he wasn't born again. He was implacable. He was feasting. He should have never been born. The Bible makes it clear that he went to his own place and he believed not. He was a devil. But there's a lot of people that just don't want to believe that. And they teach some weird doctrine. And they use Judas Iscariot as a positive example. Now, I'm not lying to you when I tell you that a couple years ago, around this time, I went to a Baptist church. And we had a Sunday school lesson. And the Sunday school lesson was how we could learn from the example of Judas Iscariot. Now, in the light of all the verses that I just showed you, what the Bible clearly says about this guy, what in the world does a Christian have fellowship with Judas Iscariot? What part is he that believeth with an infidel? What part is that Christ with Belial? The Bible makes it clear that we have no part, we should have no fellowship with devils. But we know that Judas Iscariot was a special breed. He was a special breed of a false prophet because he had so many feigned words. He had so many feigned works that it seemed like he was a believer. It seemed, I mean, Peter said, look, we all believe. It seems like it. And even when Peter was denying Christ, or not denying Christ, but Peter was saying that he would not deny Christ. He was saying he would lay down his life. The Bible says that all of the disciples said the same. So that means, I mean, Judas Iscariot is just standing right there saying the same things. He's going along the park. He's just pretending to be one of those people. But how in the world can you have a positive example from Judas Iscariot? Well, I got another article. It was called, Is Judas in Hell? Now, it's interesting how people can extract, you know, these kind of doctrines. You say, that doesn't seem like it's that important. Does it really matter if Judas is in heaven or hell? Well, it does when people start teaching a bunch of false doctrine because of it. Now, in this article, it says, no one suspected that Judas would betray Jesus, which tells me he was a believer. So now you got the first part right. All the disciples, they didn't think that Judas Iscariot was some antichrist, some devil, some betrayer, some traitor. But why in the world does that automatically make him a believer? That means he doesn't believe John chapter 6 when it says he believed not. He doesn't believe it when the Bible says that he wasn't born again. Why? Because Satan entered into his body. It says in this article, which was posted on CNN, it says, and I am not here to debate theology. The facts are the facts. I don't think Judas was the mole, like the reality show character who's there to sabotage the game from the beginning. I think he made a mistake and now has gone down as committing the biggest sin of all time. He says, look, I don't even believe he was the mole. I mean, this guy clearly doesn't believe anything in the Bible. I read for you a dozen verses that said he's a betrayer. He's a betrayer. He's a traitor. Jesus Christ said he knew from the beginning of his ministry the one who would betray him, right? I mean, this guy is the mole from the beginning, if that's the word you want to use. I think it's a stupid word because it's not a biblical word.
Right.
But clearly he was. He saw a Facebook post that said, is Judas in heaven or hell? And someone immediately said, Judas is in hell today. He's been there for 2,000 years and will be there forever. His comment was, I wish Facebook had an unfriend button. Because he just didn't like that answer, apparently. He says, I don't know who actually gets in. Do I believe in heaven or hell? Yes. I believe one is dark and one is light and they both last forever. What is interesting to me is in that upper room where Jesus and his disciples shared the Last Supper together, the 12 disciples all talked about how they were so great. Peter left the room and denied Jesus 3 times. Judas left the room and sold Jesus out for 30 coins. One committed suicide, and one went on to build the church as we know it today. Both Peter and Judas committed the same sin. Now that's not true at all. Peter did not betray the Lord Jesus Christ unto the Pharisees. He was just fearful. And you know, a lot of people, when they're pointed at a death situation where they might be crucified or killed or martyred, they might have the temptation to say, well, I'm not really a Christian. I don't really know Jesus. That's not the same as actually delivering him into the hands of the Pharisees and betraying him, giving him the kiss of death, being implacable. When Jesus is like, look, you're the one that's going to betray me. Dip the sock. Oh, it's you. He still goes out and does it. That's not the same sin. It says they both denied Jesus. No, it goes a lot further than that. But Peter did believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and Judas Iscariot did not believe. It says in this article, why do most people think one goes to heaven and one goes to hell? This is not the debate Christians need to be engaged in. We don't know. Instead of wasting our time on these types of arguments, instead of our little Christian world, maybe we should look inside ourselves this Easter. He says, but maybe as we approach Easter, we can be reminded that for Christians, the cross and the grave should silence all these debates. We all fall short and deserve death, but because of what Jesus did on the cross 2,000 years ago, we are able to have life. And I believe that where you end up, God only knows. So this guy is clearly not saved. He doesn't believe the gospel. This guy is a false prophet.
That's right.
You know, I heard this guy in my church. It was interesting. I looked at the guy's name up. He's a guy that came and visited my church back in the day. He came and preached. And this guy has what's called a ministry where he helps men that look at, you know, filthy images on the internet or look at filthy movies or look, you know, they're caught in this sin of what's called pornography. And this guy has this ministry where he goes out and he tries to reach people that are caught in this sin. But the way he does this is by getting yoked up with the most filthy, disgusting actors in these like movies and in these magazines, and he becomes their best friend to try and reach them with the gospel. And he says, well, I mean, if Judas Iscariot committed this sin, I mean, who's to say I can't hang out with these kind of people? But that's just utter foolishness. That's just the worst type of filth. We shouldn't go and just engage with all these filthy, disgusting, wicked people that hate God, that don't want to have anything to do with Him, that just commit the most abominable sins, reprobates, homosexuals, all these kind of filthy people. But they're going to use this story and say, well, Judas didn't go to hell. And Judas committed a big sin. He was with Jesus. So we should just hang out with the worst filth of the world. No! And that was the same kind of scenario that this guy's preaching in the Sunday school class. He's saying, well, if Judas Iscariot can commit the biggest sin ever, and he was with Christ, you know, we're going to commit big sins, and we should just, you know, kind of lay off him. It was just like a whole judge not sermon. And I get up to the end and I say, well, I have to disagree, because the Bible clearly says that Judas Iscariot went to hell. And I showed him a couple verses from the Bible, and the guy was like, well, I guess you're right. So the whole sermon was like a complete waste. It was just a trash. But we see this article is influencing so many people. They want to go hang out with the filth of the world. They want to go preach under these reprobates. They want to say, hey, let's go hang out with the reprobates. But that's not what Judas Iscariot was like at all. Judas Iscariot actually looked the part. Judas Iscariot wasn't hanging out at the bars. He wasn't hanging out with the whores and the whoremongers. He wasn't doing all these filthy, wicked acts. No, he was going out with the soul winners. He was going out with the disciples. He was going across the country preaching the gospel. I mean, that's not the guy that you shouldn't hang out with. None of the disciples could even discern that he was anything false. Right. They thought he was real. Even when Jesus Christ is basically point blank says that it's him, they didn't even believe it. They couldn't even understand it. So you say, well, how does that relate to me? It just means if there was somebody that's a Judas Iscariot in your life, in your church, it's not for you to know. And we shouldn't be wondering, well, I know this guy says all the right things, and he does all the right things, and he looks good, and he sounds right. I just think he's a Judas. No, we shouldn't be just trying to find the Judas, you know, Iscariot, because we feel like it or something. The Bible gives us some ways that we can catch the Judas Iscariot. What would be ways that he did? Well, he didn't believe, so we know he wasn't getting anybody saved. So probably when they were going soul winning, he was probably hanging back.
Yeah.
He probably wasn't the one preaching the gospel.
Yeah.
Maybe if you're going soul winning with somebody and they're never getting it right, they're not saying anything, they never want to talk, that might be a bad sign. Maybe, you know, if he wanted to handle the money, we find out later, not in the moment, but that he was a thief. He was taking money out of the church of God. These are kind of the manifestations of Judas Iscariot. But even with those, the disciples didn't know. And so I don't think the point is that we should look at Judas Iscariot and say, hey, this is how we're going to catch false prophets. No, that's what Jude's about. That's what 2 Peter's about. And those people are just obvious. I mean, they're just cursed children. They're preaching peace. They're doing all kinds of wicked, abominable sins. And they might look good on the outside, but we can tell they're ravening wolves on the inside by what they say. Now, Judas Iscariot, you couldn't tell by what he said. He was saying the right things. He was saying, you know, I believe. He was saying, hey, I'm not going to deny you Christ. He was saying the right things. So even if there was a Judas Iscariot among us, which there will be, Jesus Christ said that there would be people in the church that were infiltrators, that were going to be saying the right thing, we shouldn't be trying to just find the Judas Iscariot. We shouldn't be looking for him. But we most certainly shouldn't be looking for the Judas Iscariot in the whorehouse. We shouldn't be looking for him at the tavern. No, he's in the church. Judas Iscariot was among God's people. He was an infiltrator. He was a wolf with sheep's clothing on. He came in to try and, you know, deceive and betray the Lord Jesus Christ for filthy lucre's sake. So my third point was Judas was in hell. I don't know if I have enough time, but the question is, then why did he choose Judas? Why did Jesus Christ choose Judas, you know? Go to Romans chapter 9. I'll read for you Matthew chapter 26. I'm going to flip there, get a little bit more context of that verse. It says in verse 52, then said Jesus unto him, put up again thy sword into his place, for all they that take the sword shall perish with the sword. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then shall the scriptures be fulfilled that thus must be? So Jesus Christ is being taken by the chief priests, you know, minions, by the people that Judas Iscariot came with. And Peter's, you know, slaying the guy he's slaying his ear off. But Jesus Christ says, put it up. How much the scriptures must be fulfilled. The reason why Jesus Christ had all these sufferings and then these afflictions, why Judas Iscariot was there, was to fulfill scripture. That's one reason. I'll read for you in verse 56. It says, but all this was done that the scripture of the prophets might be fulfilled. Why was Judas Iscariot chosen? So the scriptures could be fulfilled. That's one reason. In John chapter 17, says, and now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I am come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one, as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Now, when you use the word perdition, I mean, everybody associates that with hell. And he says, Judas Iscariot, the son of perdition. Why? Because the scriptures might be fulfilled. Why did he choose him? Why did he lose Judas Iscariot? I mean, if Jesus Christ loses somebody, it's not because they were saved. He can't lose anybody that's saved. They're in his hand, and they're in the Father's hand. No man will pluck them out of the Father's hand. But Judas Iscariot was lost because he never believed, because he was the son of perdition. But he did all that because the scriptures might be fulfilled. And you know, in Ezekiel 28, when it's talking about Satan, it says that thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. Now, anointed just means chosen, meaning that Satan was chosen. Why was, you know, when you talk about Judas Iscariot, he was chosen. He was chosen to be the one to betray the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Probably because Jesus Christ knew his heart, that he was so reprobate, that he was so implacable, that it didn't matter what happened, he was going to betray him. There was nothing that was going to stop that train to betray him, because he hated the Lord Jesus Christ. He was twice dead. He was just wicked to the core. He was the son of perdition. But look at Romans 9, verse 15. For he saith to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it is not him that will. So then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for the same purpose that I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Go down to verse 21. Hath not the potter power over the clay, of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor, and another unto dishonor? What if God, willing to show his wrath, and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction? Now you can't blame Jesus Christ for Judas Iscariot going to hell. He got the gospel every day for 3.5 years. I mean, he had every opportunity to get saved. He has the Lord Jesus Christ right there in front of him. What more could you ask for someone to go get the gospel? I mean, you have God manifested in the flesh. You have the Word becoming flesh. You have everything coming out of his mouth that's true. I mean, you got the best chance to get saved. That's why the Bible says that God is long-suffering. But there are some that are made unto dishonor. And the vessels of wrath. He chose him so that he could show his power. Why? Because Jesus Christ had to die somehow. How was he going to die? Well, he was betrayed by somebody so the scriptures could be fulfilled. God chose that that was the way that Jesus Christ would die. He would die on the cross. He would be betrayed. That he would go down to hell for 3 days and 3 nights. That's what God chose so that he could show his power, that Jesus Christ had the keys of hell and of death. Go to John chapter 3, if you would. You know, if you think about it for a second, if God is willing to give people free will, which makes him God, because no man can create something that has free will, only God can create that which has free will. If you create a multitude of people, some people are going to reject you. Some people, that's just an inevitability of fact of giving somebody free will. If everybody just chose God, it doesn't sound like they had any free will. So there's going to be people that don't want to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that want to go to hell, that are wicked. That's why it says in Ecclesiastes 7, lo, this only have I found, that God made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions. So God's plan is for everybody to do good. He makes them upright, but then they just choose the wickedness of their own heart because they have free will. That's why Judas Iscariot betrayed him. It's because he made it of his own heart. But Jesus Christ, knowing that, chose him because he knew he was implacable. Just like Pharaoh, implacable. Just like Satan. I mean, the Bible says in 1 John, when it's talking about Jesus Christ, that he would destroy the works of the devil. That was the purpose of Jesus Christ coming to the earth, was to destroy the works of the devil. I don't have that in my notes. It says in Isaiah 14, for thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, and I will exalt my throne above the stars. Isaiah 14 says, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Satan just loves to be, you know, puff himself up. It comes from his own will. Why? Because he has free will. So he chose and rejected Jesus Christ. He rejected God. He didn't want to be God's, you know, son or follower or angel or whatever. The angels aren't sons. But Satan didn't want to be a part of God. He wanted to be God. He didn't want to be a servant of God. He wanted to be God. That's why in Romans chapter 1, probably one of the clearest places on the reprobates, says, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts. Judas Iscariot went to hell on his own accord, out of his own heart. 2 Peter 2, talking about false prophets, and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Judas Iscariot took pleasure in those things. He enjoyed it. These reprobates, they enjoy doing wicked sins. They enjoy being the betrayer, being the traitor. That's why in John chapter 3, look at verse 20. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. These people just love their sin. They love wickedness. They love filth. That's why Judas Iscariot went to hell, because he hated the light. I'll read for you in Psalms 58, one last place. It says, "Do ye indeed speak righteousness, O congregation? Do ye judge uprightly, O ye sons of men? Yea, in heart ye work wickedness. Ye weigh the violence of the hands in your earth. The wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they be born, speaking lies." And the Bible goes on and on, talks about breaking their teeth and their mouth. It says at the end of that, verse 11, says, "So that a man shall say, verily there is a reward for the righteous. Verily he's a God that judges in the earth." How could God show any mercy if there was never any judgment? I mean, if there weren't people that didn't reject Jesus Christ, how could he show, you know, mercy? If everybody just picked him, or if everybody just automatically went to heaven, if there was no hell, if Jesus Christ didn't pay for your punishment, he couldn't show mercy. That's why we see the great power of God. We see that God is just, because if there is no hell, then he's not just. I mean, all the wicked, sinful, wicked things that people do, filthy abominations, if they didn't go to hell when they rejected Jesus Christ, could you really say God's just? I think of it this way. When you go to the store and you see that parent and they've got this little bratty kid and they just start throwing a temper tantrum, they're laying on the floor, "Mom, I want candy! I want candy! Give me candy! Mom! Ah!" What are you thinking? You're like, just smack that kid! Punish him! Beat him! But then you see the parent do what? They grab the candy bar off the shelf and they just hand it to the kid. You don't think that person's just. You don't think that person's doing the right thing. How can you think that of the Lord Jesus Christ? And so much more of an example of them doing these filthy, wicked abominations. Way worse than some bratty kid. But we just know that God wouldn't be just if there's no hell. How can we see God's wrath without the vessels of dishonor? We're going to see that the people burning in hell for all of eternity. God has great wrath. That's why we can see his power. So we know that Jesus was actually in hell at this time, but he wasn't by himself. Judas was in hell too. And he's never a positive example. Not anything Christians should ever look at as an example for them in their lives. And why did Judas Iscariot go to hell? Why did Jesus choose him? Because he was implacable reprobate. He knew that he would always give him up, and it was out of his own heart. It was out of his own will. I'll give you one last verse. Revelation 1, "I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, amen, and have the keys of hell and of death." We should focus on the fact that Jesus Christ rose again this Sunday and know that he conquered death and hell for us. It should give us a greater appreciation of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you for taking the sufferings and afflictions of hell, the place that we all deserve to go so that we wouldn't have to go there, and then rising again so that we could have eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord if we place our faith and trust on him. Thank you for all that you give us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.